buzzing, beeping and pinging shows how social we already are. And yes, it is a little cold. I'm shivering myself. Great. So I essentially have a three-point agenda over here that I'm going to take you through. The first thing on my set is I'm deconstructing a Facebook page for you guys. So I hope all your laptops are open, your internet connections are ready, your dongles are plugged in, your Facebook pages are up and running. I'm going to deconstruct an entire Facebook page for you guys. How many of you guys are already on Facebook in terms of your brands? And how many brands are not on Facebook currently? Okay, very few. So for the guys that are not on Facebook currently, I'm going to walk you guys through a step-by-step procedure, and you can actually live create your Facebook page simultaneously as I take you through it. For the guys that are already on Facebook, this presentation will help you maximize and optimize the real estate on your page, will introduce you to features that you possibly weren't aware of, will correct myths of Facebook pages that you guys possibly have at the moment. Please feel free to stop me at any point of time, because this is possibly the most important activity that you will conduct in terms of creating your Facebook page. There are a lot of activities that you will do that are one-time activities that you will not be able to go back and change later on in the future. Hence, it's very important to get your basics right at step one. Please feel free to stop me. I'm happy to go as slow as required in terms of setting up the Facebook page. After we deconstruct the Facebook page, we'll walk through the do's and don'ts of Twitter. We'll walk through hashtags, so on and so forth, as Lavin said, and we'll actually live trend TIE Institute. So you guys will actually have witness to the fact as to how Twitter trends work. Time permitting, if we have time post these two activities, we'll move on to Facebook Insights, Facebook Ads, and listening tools before we wrap up the first session pre-lunch. So without much further ado, let's start by deconstructing a Facebook page. Okay, as everyone is aware, Facebook pages have now moved into the timeline format, so we're going to deconstruct a Facebook timeline page. What is a Facebook page? As most of you guys are aware, Prateek briefly touched upon why a profile is different from a group and why a group is different from a page. And today, all brands that we interact with on Facebook are on pages. So what pages are essentially doing is they're giving the ability for brands to have a voice on Facebook. So everything that an activity that a brand can do starts and ends on the page. So by leveraging our connections in the real world and multiplying them and reflecting them online, we can thereby maximize the leverage that our brands have online by the means of our pages that we create for our brands. So let's start by actually creating our timeline pages. At the bottom of your page, for the guys that don't have pages already, at the bottom of your Facebook page, if you scroll right to the bottom, you see a small little tab saying create a page. It's literally that simple. Just click on the button and you start by creating the page. Once you click on the button create a page, it will give you various options to classify what kind of a page you're building. Most of you will be creating pages for your company or your organization or the brand or the product, depending on what line you are in. So let's make an assumption here. Let's make an assumption that we are setting up a page for cute little puppies, which is a dog grooming service. So the next set of options it asks me is whether I'm listing a local business or place, or whether it's a company in an organization. A lot of you may work in multinational corporations, etc., that may have multiple offices across the country or maybe even across the world. The first thing it asks me to do is upload a profile picture. Now, when you upload a profile picture, you have three options. You can either upload it from your PC, you can put it in from your company website, or you can put it in from, about your company. This is a small little write-up just at initiation to set up basic information about your company, probably your website, your Twitter links, so on and so forth, so that users have the ability to cross-connect your Twitter page to your Facebook page, your LinkedIn profile to your Twitter page, so on and so forth. And lastly, definition of your Facebook web address. Now, it's very important to note that your Facebook address or your unique URL is a one-time standardized URL. You cannot go back and change this. So in the case of a lot of you who filled in the questionnaire that Sharon sent to you all prior to coming here, you all put in the links to your existing Facebook pages for your brands. And in a lot of the cases, I noticed that people had used abbreviations in their names for their companies. People had used special characters to replicate for E's and S's. It's important to note that once you've defined the Facebook web address, you cannot go back and change it. Therefore, it's very imperative that you define the Facebook web address correctly without using acronyms or abbreviations or special characters or numbers as replications for actual words. Because ideally, this is the name of your Facebook page. So hypothetically, my Facebook page for my company is www.facebook.com/bfoxy. So when I want to redirect people to my Facebook page for my company, it's as simple as me giving out my unique URL, which is www.facebook.com/bfoxy. Okay. Before we start customizing our page, this is the bare naked view and structure of how the Facebook timeline page exists. I'm sure you guys must have seen various multiple versions of this page in existence after it's been populated with a variety of content, but this is how the naked skeleton of the page looks. Please feel free to stop me at any point in time. If you don't have a Facebook page, then yes, I can slow down if you like. I can take things slightly slower if you are doing it live as we speak. And
what do you expect? Do it parallelly or would you be going to later?
If anyone is doing this parallelly, Lavin or Prateek can sit down with you on one of the tables to cross consult you. We can slow down a little bit. Is anyone doing this live? Okay, I'll slow down a little. Should I go back a couple of steps? Where should I go back to? The step behind this is what? Step ahead. Okay. So we clicked on create Facebook page. Yeah. The next step is we're taken to a page in which we have to select the type of the organization. So if someone is setting up a Facebook page for a band, you jump into artist, band, or public figure. If you're, sorry, yes.
Sorry to interrupt. I just missed out the difference between a group and a page.
Okay. So what a group initially did a couple of years ago before brands migrated from groups onto pages is groups had a limit to the number of users that could populate a group. So when a group hit 5,000 people, the group froze there. You could not populate the group higher than 5,000 people. Often a group became a closed community as opposed to page, which became an open-ended community. So today as a brand, I would like my brand to be open and be as publicly viewable as possible to anyone in the world, even if they are not my consumer, because it is increasing my brand awareness and my brand visibility. A group had the option of narrowing down that subset of 5,000 people to closing the group. Conversations were limited to within the group, and because groups were a slightly more closed structure, the virality of content in order to actually share and cross-promote that content was very narrow. Further, groups also had a limit to the number of people that you could multiply message at the same time, which is why groups became redundant and obsolete. Today, not for brands, but for smaller organizations, like for instance, if any of you are members of a Rotaract organization or an ISEC organization, very often these smaller close-knit groups that only need to communicate within themselves are doing so on groups, because these groups do not need public and open forums to talk to one another. They need a close-knit forum where only members of that particular group are interacting with each other and thereby have the privilege of sharing content with one another that can only be consumed by that subset of people within the group. But today, if I'm a brand, if I'm a beauty spa, I want to be talking to everyone who lives in Bandra, Juhu, Andheri, so on and so forth, that can potentially become my consumer. So why would I limit myself to a subset of 5,000 people who are sharing content and consuming content only within that group, wherein the ability to share and viral that content extrapolates to the entire universe if I then migrate that group from a group onto a page?
Well,
you cannot technically migrate a group onto a page. You need to recreate the page. You need to restart the page from scratch. And all the equity and the fan base that you have generated, to be honest, is null and void. You need to then post links to your page in order to redirect users. But you cannot migrate a database from a group onto a page. That's not technically possible. Yeah, you can delete the page. Of course you can. You can. You can shut down a page altogether. Yeah. Shall we move forward? Okay. Okay, so I've selected brand or product in terms of definition of what my page shall be. So I'm now then prompted to define the relevant category of my brand or product. So very simply speaking, as you see on the top left of my page, I have a drop-down that actually allows me to select the category. So for instance, if someone is marketing a deodorant on the internet, the category selected would be an FMCG. If someone is marketing a medicine, the category would be pharma. Very simple industry to category. Should I move forward? Yep. Great. So let's look at the setup test now. The first step of setting up your Facebook page is definition of your profile picture. As we discussed previously, your profile picture can either be uploaded from your computer, wherein you possibly already have your logo saved, or you have artwork that you'd like to use for your profile picture saved on your desktop, or you could then pull it in through a website, which is ideally your company website or any other website that's currently hosting the picture that you would like to represent as your profile picture on your Facebook fan page. Clear, clear. Should we move forward?
One question is, the element of your page that can I create my company's page using my personal ID?
To be honest, when you create a page, your personal identity is hidden. No one knows that I, in my individual capacity of being Suvir Bajaj, has now created 10 pages for 10 brands of mine. Whether they may be my brands or brands that I represent, your personal identity is never divulged or revealed to anyone as the administrator or the creator of that page, except for the other administrators of the page. So for instance, if you and I co-create and co-manage a page, I will know that you have created it and you will know that I manage it. But the 10,000 people that consume the content on that page will not know that you as an individual, from your individual capacity, have anything at all to do with that page. That is another differentiator between a page and a group. On a group, it's public information as to who has created the group. On a page, it's not public information. A lot of people are very apprehensive to create pages from their own personal profile under the impression that their inboxes will start getting spammed. Their identity will be revealed. But the identity is never revealed. No one other than the administrators of the page know who have created the page and know who manage or run the page. Absolutely. In fact, today Facebook allows you to represent yourself as either yourself or a brand of a page that you have created on Facebook. So for instance, if I log on to Facebook through my own personal ID, I can then switch my voice of representation to a brand whose page I have created. So for instance, if I have created 20 pages and it's Diwali today and I want to wish all my consumers across various pages in the eyes of Maybelline, moving forward from the same example that Prateek shared with you, I can then change my voice of representation to speaking as Maybelline. So no one knows Suvir Bajaj is behind Maybelline. But Maybelline is going and posting Diwali wishes and celebrations on its, possibly on its groups and the walls of its pages and the walls of its fans, so on and so forth.
So in fact, even after you create a page in your account, you can pass on the administrative privileges to others to manage.
Right.
You can add while you hold the control.
Right.
Okay, the second tab is very, very self-explanatory about your business, basic information, what you do, products and services that you deal in, price points, locations, anything that you may feel relevant to put in a small little snippet to very quickly educate your consumers as to what you do. This page also allows you to put URLs of cross-promoted pages that are not hosted on Facebook, such as your Twitter page, your corporate website, your blog, your LinkedIn profile, any other third-party link off of Facebook that you may feel is relevant to the consumer's interaction once he's become a fan on Facebook. Sorry, any questions before we move forward? With regards to the profile picture and content text for about. Okay, great. Facebook web address. So the Facebook web address essentially is a unique URL, as I explained. Today as individuals, we also have unique URLs. So for instance, if any of you wanted to access my personal profile, the only thing you needed to know was that my personal profile is accessible at www.facebook.com/Suvir. Irrespective of the privacy settings that I have, you will still be able to see possibly my profile picture and my name if you visit www.facebook.com/Suvir. Similarly, every brand also has a Facebook web address, which is a unique URL. So hypothetically, as I told you, my company's Facebook web address is www.com/Suvir. B, Foxy, which is the representation address that my company uses for its Facebook page on the internet. Similarly, each of your brands must have a unique URL when you define the page. This is imperative because when you want to share your page with people, whether it's on the internet, whether it's on the means of a flyer, today you drive down Pedder Road, you see huge Nike hoardings, and they say, visit us at www.facebook.com/NikeCricket. It's literally as simple as that. Back in the day, if you remember, groups had group IDs. Pages were named by group IDs, wherein you access the page by going to www.facebook.com/group-ID1600-!! God knows where that goes. How do you share that URL? You cannot share that URL. So in terms of shareability, it becomes very important for your consumers, for your shareability of your Facebook page, that you define an accurate and grammatically correct with a unique URL that's simplistically understandable and shareable to your user. As I said, don't use numerics as representative of letters. Don't use special characters that complicate the visibility and the shareability of your unique URL. Do not use acronyms. Do not use abbreviations.
Bhavin?
Questions? Okay.
So, I think everybody doesn't get the web address option on the first go. Common not to get when you're creating a page, you may not get the option to have a web address.
In the event that you don't get the option to create a web address by default, what you need to do is get a minimum of 25 fans on your page, which is a piece of cake. Just send your page, direct message your page to about 25 friends. Get 25 friends. 25 is the minimum number of fans you must have on your page in order to activate this option if it isn't pre-activated. The minute you have 25 fans, this option will activate itself for you. It still would, depending on your own personal profile. So within your personal profile, you've created X many number of pages that have gotten indexed and have X many number of fans, you get the option by default. If not, just invite 25 of your friends to like your page, this option will activate itself for you. Of course, absolutely. The minute you have 25 fans, this option will activate itself for you. Okay, so skeleton naked structure of how the timeline page actually looks. Should we dive into the elements, or is everyone very familiar with this page as it looks by itself?
I'm not getting it. It is on Twitter.
Sorry, we should dive into it. Okay, I'll actually take you through each element very specifically. So instead of we'll jump into each element specifically as we go into the I'm just going to first show you some branded pages as they exist today before we jump into the various elements and how as individuals you can customize each of these elements in order to suit the adaptability of your brand. So this is how Facebook pages in their finished form currently look like. I'll take you through each various element, but what this essentially shows you is the personality that a Facebook page can extrapolate through the means of its visual communication just from a simplistic, naked, visible view. So we have Coca-Cola, Wendy's, Red Bull. Yeah, thanks. Okay, I'm going to go back to Red Bull. This thing you see over here is called the cover photo. On the top again, this is the cover photo. Now let's talk a little bit about the cover photo. What is the cover photo? The cover photo essentially is the first thing that anyone that logs onto your page sees. It gives you the ability to make a first impression on your consumer. Whether the person has liked the page or not is irrelevant. The cover photo will be visible to anyone that lands on the page, irrespective of whether they're a fan or a non-fan. Okay. It's also imperative to note that you are discouraged from putting a call to action in the cover photo. So for instance, as we indicate, no feature like no asking a user for a call to action like sharing the page or having any contact information on a cover photo for a branded page is advisable at all. Okay, These dimensions are very important to note when you want to go ahead and customize your own cover photos. As you must have noticed, there's a specific dimension that a cover photo takes. Today in our personal profiles, we just select any image for the cover photo to kind of overtake, and Facebook automatically selects 850 by 315 pixels off that. So this stat is very important to note. When you do create your own cover photos, do so in a resolution of 850 by 315 pixels. Very simply speaking, if you guys are a little familiar with Photoshop, open up Photoshop, when selecting the canvas size, select 850 by 315 pixels. In the event that you're not so tech savvy, you're not so design savvy, ensure that your cover photos are minimum of 300-400 pixels across. But the ideal representation size for a cover photo is 850 by 315 pixels. The profile picture, which is this, which is a subset of the cover photo, is 180 by 180 pixels. It appears next to every post that I post as the brand, whether it's on my own page, whether it's on another page, whether the same post then reflects on the wall, whether the same post then reflects on the timeline, whether the same post then reflects on another page. A 30 by 30 thumbnail of that, a 30 by 30 thumbnail of that profile picture will then appear next to any and all posts that are made through the representative voice of the brand whose page I am talking through. Ideally speaking, the profile picture is usually a variation of the logo which color coordinates with the cover photo, but because of the strategic placement of the profile picture with the logo, brands now use the combination of the cover photo and the profile picture strategically in order to create interesting designs. Any questions at this juncture?
You mentioned call to action should be there on cover.
Should not be there. Discouraged.
Like why they should be inclusive?
Yeah.
Call to action.
They can even shut down your page.
Now.
If you put a call to action on the cover photo here, it violates Facebook policies. So they can shut down your page. So this is just an example of creative photo covers where you see the cover photos then gone on to a tab and the profile pictures again strategically placed in order to match its background.